Hi everyone, I will talk about why you should think twice before using GPUs in software packet processing. This is joint work with Dong Zhao, Michael Kaminsky, and my advisor, Dave Anderson. Software packet processing is important. Its flexibility is useful in research and development, and it gets work done on a low budget when speed is not important, for example, in firewalls. Unfortunately, it is also much slower than specialized ASICs. And there has been a lot of recent research to improve performance, and using GPU acceleration is one of the main techniques. This slide shows a partial list of recent projects that use GPUs to accelerate different packet processing tasks. And not only are there many examples of using GPUs to accelerate specific functionality, such as IPv4 and named data networking, there are also several generalized frameworks that make GPU acceleration easier. And this figure shows the speed up that we got with GPU acceleration for three applications: IPv4 forwarding, IPv6 forwarding, and a layer 2 switch. This speedup is over our baseline code, and it is similar to the speedups claimed by prior GPU work. And this looks good. The GPU gives a 2x speedup for the switch, and over a 4x speedup for IPv6 forwarding. I will show in this talk that it is possible to get similar speedups by simply optimizing the baseline CPU code with an automatic code transformation, that is, GPU-like speedups without using any GPUs. And our transformation works for all packet programs that are written under the same constraints as GPU code. The blue bars show the speedup from our transformation, which is pretty close to the GPU speedups. It is slightly lower in some cases, but it also requires fewer resources because it does not use an extra GPU. Here is a brief overview of CPU and GPU-based packet processing. In CPU-only packet processing, we have a multi-core CPU connected to several network cards. The CPU receives a packet from a network, performs some processing on it, and sends it out on a destination port. Now let's add a GPU. GPUs have a large number of execution units, which makes them very attractive devices for parallel processing. They have an order of magnitude higher raw computing power than most CPUs, and they have several factors higher memory bandwidth. To exploit the GPU's parallelism, the CPU first collects a batch of packets from the network and ships it over to the GPU or PCI Express. The GPU processes the packets in this batch in parallel and returns the results to the CPU. And a lot of prior work claims that GPU offloading is beneficial, even though it involves this extra overhead of transferring and marshaling data to and from the GPU. We did some analysis to single out the main advantage that GPUs have over CPUs for packet processing applications. And the details of this analysis are in the paper, but at a high level, we found that for many applications, the main GPU advantage is not their higher computing power or memory bandwidth, but their ability to transparently hide memory access latency. The reason why that happens is that most packet processing tasks, like try lookups or hash table lookups, are not very compute or memory intensive. For these tasks, the gains from the higher compute power or memory bandwidth of the GPU is not enough to make up for the overhead of offloading computation to the GPU. So our claim is that the main GPU advantage comes from their ability to hide memory latency. And the CPU's memory bandwidth is in fact sufficient for most packet processing programs, but CPUs are just unable to utilize their bandwidth because of the way packet programs are written. Memory latency hiding is an important technique, and there are ways to do it in both hardware and software. GPUs provide hardware support for latency hiding, and here's how that works. Suppose thread one is running on a GPU core, and now it wants to do a long latency access to memory. Instead of waiting for 100 nanoseconds for this memory access to complete, the GPU scheduler instead switches out thread 1 and starts running thread 2 on this GPU core, thereby hiding the memory latency behind some useful work. And when thread 2 does an expensive memory access, thread 1 is switched back in. This context switching is architecturally supported by GPU hardware by using a large number of registers to save and restore thread state. And the hardware support makes these context switches fast enough for latency hiding, unlike traditional thread switching on CPUs, which actually takes an order of magnitude longer than a memory access. So now that we know that the main GPU advantage is memory latency hiding, we should also try to do memory latency hiding for CPU-based packet programs. But unfortunately, the hardware support for memory latency hiding on CPUs is not that good. But there are several software techniques. For example, CuckooSwitch uses a manual technique called group prefetching to hide DRAM latency, and Grappa uses a lightweight context switching mechanism to hide the latency of remote memory accesses. But both these prior approaches have major limitations, which led us to develop our own new approach. I will use the code on this slide to discuss memory latency hiding technique. And this code is a very simple batch hash table lookup. It takes B keys as input and returns B values as output. This code processes the keys one by one, and in the first step for any key, it computes an index into the hash table to find the value pointer. In the second step, it dereferences the value pointer to actually get the value, and then it copies the value to the output array. The two highlighted instructions which read the hash table entry and the value can miss in cache if the hash table is large, leading to long stalls in the processor's pipeline, and we would like to hide the latency of these instructions. Here is the common group prefetching technique of memory latency hiding. It splits the code into stages that are separated by expensive memory access instructions, and here's how it works. It starts by computing a hash for the first key, and then instead of stalling on the memory access for the hash table entry, it instead issues a prefetch for the entry's address and starts to compute the hash for the second key. In this way, it can hide memory latency by overlapping the first memory access with the second hash computation. Then it does the same thing for the second and third key, and if B is 3, now the code goes back to actually accessing the hash table entry for the first key. This might take some time if the prefetch has not yet completed, but the stall time is much smaller than without prefetching. And then the code goes back to doing work for the first key. The problem with this approach is that it requires splitting the input code into stages that are separated by expensive memory access instructions, which is impossible or inefficient to do for code with complicated control flow. This figure on the left is the control flow graph of the toy hash table that I've been discussing till now, and it is easy to separate this graph into stages by making some horizontal cuts. But the figure on the right is the control flow graph for the cuckoo hash table, which we use as a building block in two of our benchmark applications. It is very difficult to divide this graph into stages because the control flow is very nonlinear. So we decided that restructuring code to hide memory latency is a hard problem. The other technique to hide memory latency is switching, but we need the switching to be fast. Now, general purpose thread switching on CPUs is of course very slow, but we found that switching can be fast if we restrict ourselves to the sort of programs that people run on GPUs. The ideal GPU code is batched and independent. The GPU code processes a batch of elements, and the code for each element is independent of each other. This allows the GPU to process the different elements in parallel with multiple threads without any coordination among the threads. For example, the code inside the red box here is batch independent, and it would run really well on a GPU. Our main idea is that we can make switching on CPUs very fast if we have batch independent code. Let us look at the spectrum of context switching mechanisms. This line shows the generality versus speed trade-off in context switching, and on the left extreme, we have general purpose kernel threads, which are independent and preemptively scheduled, but they are pretty slow when it comes to switching. The context switch time for kernel threads is around 500 nanoseconds, which is only fast enough to hide hard disk latency. Somewhere in the middle, we have Grappa's user level threads, which are cooperatively scheduled and must belong to the same application, but they still take around 25 nanoseconds to switch. This makes them fast enough to hide the latency of fast networks such as InfiniBand, but they are still somewhat inefficient for hiding memory latency. At the right extreme, we have GPUs, which have hardware support for thread switching, but they also have the additional baggage of making the programmer write batch independent code. GPU threads are derived from the elements of a batch function, so switching between threads is actually identical to switching between the elements of a batch function. Our switching technique is called GOPT, and its generality is similar to GPU thread switching. Just like GPUs, GOPT also switches between the elements of a batch independent function, but it does so on CPUs without hardware support. GOPT is fast because it is specialized to handle just one batch independent function, and this restriction allowed us to do several optimizations. For example, we can save state for different elements in local arrays instead of a separate memory location, and we can switch using a single go-to instruction instead of saving and restoring a lot of registers. Although it's slightly hard to measure the exact switching time of GOPT, we can do anywhere between 100 to 300 million switches per second. Of course, GOPT is much more specific than either kernel threads or Grappa, which do not require batching or independence, and they can also hide latency across function calls. Let us take a look at how GOPT works by applying it on the hash table example. And for simplicity, let us start with the code for a single element. To know when the program does an expensive memory access in the absence of hardware support, GOPT requires the programmer to add two expensive annotations just before the expensive accesses using a keyword called expensive. To convert this single element code into batched code, we need to convert all local variables into arrays, and replace all local variable uses with array accesses. Here is the batched code with arrays, and the newly added text is shown in red. All local variable uses have been replaced with array accesses with capital I as the index, which is also the index of the batch element which is currently being processed by geopt. This code doesn't make sense right now because it is not actually looping over all the elements, but we will fix that. Here's the same code again with the red color removed. And now we need some switching logic for the two expensive memory accesses. We do the switching in three steps called prefetch, save, and switch, which are encoded using the macro shown on the right. When element I wants to do an expensive memory access, we issue a prefetch for the access, save the current program point for element I, and switch to element I plus 1. The switching is done by simply incrementing I and executing a goto to element I plus 1's saved program point. So now we have replaced the annotations with the switching logic. The switching logic is just two lines of code. The first line does the switching, and the second line is a label which is used as the program point to return to from the switch. Now we need some control code to ensure that this actually works, which consists of setup code at the top and some termination code at the bottom. The setup code initializes capital I to 0 to start processing from the first batch element. And the program point for each batch element is initialized to label 0, that is to the start of the real code. The termination code basically guarantees that the top level function returns only after it finishes processing all elements, and the details of this are in the paper. Geopt basically guarantees that all elements start processing at label 0 and go through label end, which guarantees correctness under the batch independent assumption. One interesting thing about geopt is that we are actually adding more variables, more code, and more branches to the input code, but we still call it an optimization. This graph shows the factor increase in geopt for factor increase in instruction count with geopt for three benchmark programs. Geopt increases the number of instructions executed significantly. For example, for IPv6 lookups, geopt executes 2.3 times more instructions than the input code. However, the reason why geopt works is that it increases the instructions per cycle by an even larger amount by avoiding memory access stalls. Again, for example, for IPv6 lookups, the increase in IPC is 4.6 times, which means an overall speed up of 2x. The figure on the right shows the overall speed up achieved by geopt and by manual group prefetching. Geopt speed up is within 5% of manual optimization, which is acceptable because geopt is automatic and works for programs with complicated control flow. We applied geopt to four packet processing applications with different levels of computation and memory access. And to ensure that geopt works on real world code, we used IPv4 and IPv6 forwarding code from the DPDK library. All these applications required only one or two annotations, even though the last two are reasonably complicated code. Here are the two devices that we compared. The CPU is an 8-core Sandy Bridge from Intel with 51.2 gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth. The GPU is the very recent GTX 980 from NVIDIA with over 2,000 execution units and 4.4 times higher sequential memory bandwidth. For network I/O, we use two dual-port 10 gigabit NICs on the server for a total bandwidth of 40 gigabits per second. This slide will compare the throughput of the CPU and the GPU for IPv4 forwarding. But first, the dotted green line shows our hardware's packet forwarding limit. To plot this line, we measured the rate at which our CPU cores were able to receive packets from the network and send them back out on a random port without any processing. The y-axis shows throughput in millions of packets per second, and the x-axis shows number of CPU cores dedicated to packet processing. The solid green line shows the IPv4 forwarding throughput of our baseline CPU code. The performance drop is very noticeable, even though the processing required in IPv4 lookups is very little. It's just around one random memory access. The solid red line shows IPv4 forwarding throughput of our GPU accelerated system. And there are three interesting things going on with the red line. The first interesting thing is that its throughput with one CPU core is zero. This happens because we use the first CPU core as a master core, which collects packets from the other worker cores and shuffles them to and from the GPU. That is, the first master core does not do any network I/O for the GPU accelerated system. Second, the red line looks like the dotted green line shifted one unit to the right. This is because we have one less core to get packets on and off the network, and the GPU can keep up with the network rate. Third, the solid line eventually gets higher than the solid green line, meaning that GPU acceleration can give speedups even when the amount of offloaded computation is very small. However, when we optimize the baseline by applying GOPT, its per core throughput increases by 1.6 times, and it is always faster than the GPU version. An interesting thing here is that IPv4 performance with GOPT is very close to our CPU forwarding limit. That is, the cost of an IPv4 lookup is just around 9%. And the reason why GOPT's IPv4 is only 9% slower than the forwarding limit is that GOPT is successfully able to hide the latency of the one random memory access required in IPv4 lookups. Our layer 2 switch offloads a more significant amount of computation to the GPU, and now we really start to see the gains from GPU offloading. However, GOPT increases per core throughput by 1.8 times and performs similarly to the GPU. For IPv6 forwarding, GOPT increases per core throughput by 3.8 times. This gain is much larger than the gains for the other two applications because IPv6 lookups require much more memory accesses whose latency can be hidden by GOPT. And with GOPT, the gap between CPU and GPU throughput is pretty small, but one interesting thing here is that the GPU is actually faster if both GOPT and the GPU are restricted to 4 CPU cores. However, this comparison is not fair in terms of resources because the GPU version is using 4 CPU cores and a GPU, whereas GOPT is just using 4 CPU cores. We can make the comparison slightly fairer by allowing GOPT to use one extra CPU core. That is, GOPT uses 5 CPU cores and the GPU uses 4 cores and a GPU. With this new comparison, GOPT is actually slightly faster, which means that the gains from adding a GPU are similar to the gains from adding just one CPU core. This is also true for NDN forwarding and the layer 2 switch, and you can read about the exact numbers in our paper. As GPUs are pretty expensive and power-hungry devices, one CPU core is usually a better resource investment than an entire GPU. So for our hardware and the 4 applications that we evaluated, CPUs are actually more resource efficient than GPUs. One of our key insights is that under the same assumptions as GPU code, we can do some interesting optimizations for CPU code. In this talk, I discussed how GOPT can hide DRAM latency for batched independent code. But there are more types of principled optimizations that you can do under GPU assumptions. For example, we were able to get a 2.4x speedup for the pattern matching phase of intrusion detection. This was done using manual optimizations like packet reordering and interleaving, which are perfectly legal under the batched independent assumption. We have only identified a starting set of applications in this work, but we believe that the pattern of using GPU-friendly assumptions to derive CPU-centric optimizations applies to a lot of networking and packet processing applications. So in this talk, I told you about CPU code optimizations that you can do under the batched independent code assumption that GPUs make. I showed how a fast switching mechanism can hide the memory latency of such programs and make CPUs more resource efficient than GPUs for several packet processing applications. And finally, although there are definitely times and places where GPUs will shine, even in packet processing, we have given a method of generating better CPU baselines for future GPU evaluations. And the code for all our benchmarks and the GOPT code transformation is available online. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Matthew Grosvenor from Cambridge. This is really interesting work, really, really cool. Just a very quick question about your methodology. When you were getting these packets, where were they coming from? Were they coming through the regular socket interfaces, or were you using some kind of a bypass mechanism?
We use Intel DBDK.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
So I actually had a question. I think this is also very interesting work. You know, you looked a lot at sort of this IP lookup aspect of it, but have you thought about sort of how these techniques could apply more widely to the network stack for, you know, other types of rule processing, rate limiting, anything that people have looked at?
Have people looked at doing that on GPUs too?
Well, I mean, potentially rule processing, but.
Yeah, we did look at packet classification towards the end of this work, but we have not completed that. So one thing that people do in packet classification is they compute a lot of masks, and you cannot do latency hiding in that, but you can potentially use vectorization, which is also possible if you're actually using batching.
Okay. Hey, Manu Bansal, Stanford. Very interesting. Just you mentioned that this works, I mean, this is really useful when the control flow graph is really complicated. Mm-hmm. Is that how the typical graph looks like for network processing, or how far is it from a DAC?
Actually, One of the applications which we haven't been able to manually optimize is NDN forwarding. So if you look at our NDN forwarding code, I have not actually applied manual optimization to that, even though I would like to, because the code is just so complicated. But with our transformation, you just run a script on it, and it gets transformed into a nice form which runs faster. And even for IPv6 lookups, it requires some application-specific knowledge, and you need to understand the code's logic to transform the code manually. And that's because the logic is slightly complicated.